This is Johnny Blue Star. Welcome to Threshold, a global media event. This is Johnny Blue Star. Welcome to Threshold, a global media event. Is the universe just a random dance of atoms? Or is it a manifestation of a supremely intelligent architect? Can its purpose, or our purpose here on Earth, be adequately assessed? Can we commune with it, know its intentions, cooperate with its direction? Here, we define Threshold as a gateway state of awareness, allowing mankind to cross into a place of real cognition. Threshold allows us to approach questions of higher reality through the door of experience rather than mere belief. Welcome to Threshold, where we tear away the veil from commercial media, bringing our audience and participants into another realm of reality and enhanced communication. This is Johnny Blue Star. Our featured guest today is Patricia Welch, who is appearing on our special program called The Evolution of a Singer. Before introducing you to our guest in person, let us begin our program with a song we will well recognize as performed by Patricia Welch.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there.
This song not only rekindles a feeling of love for country in me, but also has a distinctly personal association. The fact is, I went to St. John's College in Annapolis, the third oldest college in America. This was the very same school as the author of the Star Spangled Banner, Francis Scott Key, went to. It was said that Key sat, when engrossed in his studies, under this mammoth tree we call the Liberty Tree. In fact, I studied under the same tree. That was a wonderful performance, Patricia. Welcome to Threshold. How are you doing today?
I'm fine, thank you, Johnny. Thank you for having me.
I love the way you sang our national anthem, but it was not the first time you performed it. In fact, I think you performed it in many different places.
I have. I've sung for presidents, President Ford, President Clinton. I've sung it for the wonderful General Schwarzkopf. He is just such a great person, and
yes.
I miss him. You know, he passed recently, but he was just a great guy, and I love singing the national anthem, as well as many other patriotic songs like America the Beautiful and God Bless America and all these great patriotic songs that are what our country is all about.
I believe the lyrics and mood of this song precisely define the spiritual power behind our founding fathers' vision, particularly by some precious words from the original very last stanza. I'm going to read them. Oh, thus be it ever, when free men shall stand between their loved home and the war's desolation, blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us a nation. Then conquer we must when our cause it is just, and this be our motto, in God is our trust. And the Star-Spangled Banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. This song kind of paraphrases one of the mottos associated with America. It says, in God is our trust. We have simplified it to say, in God we trust. How has this phrase, in God we trust, affected your view of America and your own career?
Well, I think that in God we trust is kind of the foreground of our nation. I mean, it's our founding fathers and how they, you know, I think that's what keeps us together. And I think also another line that you said that I think is so important in that song and so true for America is our land of the free and home of the brave. I mean, we are so lucky as a nation because we still have our freedom, and so many nations don't have that. And I can say that we have the bravest men and women out there fighting for us. Americans, it's a true core of our being in America, of having people that are just a melting pot. And I think I just strongly believe, I'm so proud to be an American. You know, in spite of whatever problems there might be in the world, I think that we're very lucky to have the freedom and have the brave men and women that fight for us.
Yeah. And, you know, war is a horrible thing. But, I mean, back to that thing back to the brave men and women of, you know, fighting and believing in our country and believing in our nation, you know, that's so important. And we always pray for peace, of course. We always do. And we hope that someday we can all be unified everywhere. But once again, I'm very proud to be an American. And I think this is the greatest country to live. And I love being in Southern California, too. It's a great place to live also. So
it really is.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I know, because we both met there and I lived there for many years. But the way we met was quite unlikely. And given the spiritual direction of Threshold, that is, its contention that the universe is not just a random, unplanned toss of the dice, it would be interesting for you to relate how we met.
Well, you know, it is very interesting. I'll tell you, it's with the wide world web, the internet, I actually was working with a Russian composer, and I met him through the internet also. And his name is Edgar Ahrens. He is phenomenal. He writes very cinematic, very beautiful music, great for movies. And I was working with Edgar, and he said that he had a partner that was his lyricist, and that just turned out to be you. But the interesting thing about the story is that when I found out who the lyricist was and where the lyricist lived, I was floored. I was just amazed because you lived in Palm Springs, and I lived just like 20 minutes away. It was just like, oh my gosh, a hop and a skip.
When I heard him say you were from Quinta, I did not get it. And I would not have believed that was from La Quinta. I was really shocked.
Small world.
Yeah.
You know, what I found out in life is that if you are on the right kind of track, things like that start to happen. It's like there's some kind of guidance.
It is. They call it the, you know, fate. And it is there. I believe in that. I believe in deja vu. I believe in fate. I believe in all those things because I think we're all kind of in this universe meant to be for a certain reason to connect. And I'm glad I met you. I'm glad I met Edgar because we're doing some wonderful things. So with music.
I think it's possible that Edgar's listening in from Moscow.
Oh, wow.
Yes, I was chatting with him a few minutes before the show.
Yes, now it's morning here. It's probably nighttime there for him, right?
Yeah, it would be.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Patricia, getting on to another subject here. You've had a lot of experience in your life trying to find out, like, how to move forward in a career that is kind of as dramatic as your songs. And I wonder if many times you perhaps you've experienced a bit of confusion in that area. Is that true?
Well,
trying to know exactly how to strategically move forward in your career.
Yeah, I think everybody struggles with that, you know, making the right decision, being in the right place, trying to have a plan and so forth. But I don't think I had major struggles with that because I've always, good things have fallen into my path for, you know, even though I was a mother, I was a housewife, and my family was very, very, you know, first for me. But some great things happened in my career, and I guess part of it was being talent part, and then I think the other part was being in the right place at the right time. And but I've always had a drive, and I've always had a love for music, great singers. You know, when I was a child, I listened to Gordon McRae and Shirley Jones, and you know, Broadway was always something that I loved, you know, when I was a child growing up. And I guess things started from that. Basically, you know, when I was a child, I lived out in the country, and it was just an outlet for me. And I lived in the hills of West Virginia. In fact, I used to go walk up a hill and sit on a grassy hill and sing The Sound of Music.
Really?
Yes. So it's always been part of me, even though, as I said, I'm a housewife, I'm a mother, but I've had some great career breaks along the way for being kind of set back in the shadows a little bit, I should say. I wasn't never really, you know, like super driven or like, oh, I got to be here, I've got to go to New York, I've got to go to L.A. Never really felt that. But when I did, good things seemed to happen whenever I happened to be there. So,
Wayne Dyer has a set of books, but one of the things that he did is he did a movie called The Shift. And it talks about moving from ambition to purpose. And I think that people who are on purpose, they don't feel this kind of desperation.
Mm-hmm.
But you know something, in your CD, you have a song which does provide some kind of a picture of confusion. I think it is kind of a romantic song, but I think it has a meaning for those of us who are confused and don't exactly really need to do a kind of self-assessment. It's called Do You Know Where You're Going To?
Yes, and Diana Ross, you know, recorded that and from the theme from Mahogany. But it does. It has great lyrics, and I always think of that. You know, we have to have some kind of path, some kind of direction. You know, we can't just be, you know, we have to have some kind of direction. So, yes, and I've always liked that song.
Well, we're going to play now. Do You Know?
Okay.
Patricia?
Yes.
Isn't that beautiful? I mean, now, tell us something about the CD collection that you have.
Okay. Well, the CD collection is called Music for Great Entertaining, and it's a 46-song, 3-CD set, and it's split into 3 CDs, and the first one is called Cocktails with Patricia, Dinner with Patricia, and Dessert with Patricia. And I actually came up with that idea because, you know, I've been to a lot of dinner parties, cocktail parties and dinner parties, and, you know, a lot of times they're playing music, but it doesn't have a kind of like the best flow. And so what I did was I came up with the best, in my opinion, you know, what I thought was the best hit songs spanning from the 1940s all the way into the 90s. But mostly, most of the stuff's like from the 70s and 80s, that great music, that great core music like Melissa Manchester and Dionne Warwick and Barbara Streisand. And this kind of music makes great background music. It's very easy listening, very soothing. And so that's kind of how I came up with the idea to do this. And it just makes a great hostess gift too, you know, to have this 3-CD set that can play for the entire evening from cocktails all the way through dessert.
You know something, Patricia? What I know, we were going to play it, and it's. I really think that we should now try and listen to at least the beginning of the national anthem, and maybe you could, after we finish playing it, we could discuss a little bit more about the where it was recorded and what you did with it. Okay, so okay. We're going to play now the Star Spangled Banner. Yeah, this is Johnny. Going back to the national anthem, I feel that the lyrics and the mood of the song very precisely defines the spiritual power behind our founding father's vision. And I think that's one of the reasons that we did so well, is that we were aligned with something tremendously powerful, which is reflected, I think, in the Declaration, the Constitution. I think that real patriotism to America kind of begins with that alignment. And if we could keep that alignment, we would be in a safer, more perfect world.
Absolutely.
I think that there, besides the actual text of these things or the songs of these things, I think there's something that was in the heart of our founding fathers, like Washington and Madison and Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Paine, all these people, that was just absolutely almost miraculous, because they were breaking away from traditions of basically a monarchy and oligarchy of different sorts, and they actually formulated a way to actually bring us a sense of freedom and liberty that had never really been experienced before in history.
Absolutely, yeah.
When did you actually record that, the Star Spangled Banner?
Gosh, let's see. It's been a while. I think I've had that recording out for about 7 years. 7 or 8 years.
Where did you record it?
I actually recorded it in Las Vegas.
Ah.
In a studio in Las Vegas. Uh-huh. And I love that rendition, because it kind of has that little bit tag part. It's like it's the traditional national anthem, but that sort of has another piece added to it. And I don't know the words word for word, but I like the added part of that song. So it wasn't actually part of the national, it was kind of a combination of the national anthem. I don't know if the listeners had a chance to listen to that, but at the very, very beginning it was, or kind of in the middle of it, it segued into a different section.
Well, let's get to the sort of heart of what we're doing here. The show is called The Evolution of the Singer, and since our show, Threshold, is about personal transformation, even spiritual transformation, we'd like to hear more about your career, your philosophy, and your understanding of how things evolved from the very beginning. So apparently you were brought up in a fairly, would you call it a rural area?
Yes, very rural. I lived 3.5 miles from my high school, and it was way out in the country. The nearest house was about, maybe like 4 blocks away. So it wasn't like there was one house after another. It was very, very, very rural. And when I was growing up and I was in high school, they built a new high school that they consolidated three towns and to make it like one big high school. And for us, it was big. And they had a wonderful fine arts program, and they decided to do musicals every spring. And so I remember asking my mother, I was like 14 or 15 years old, and I said, Mom, I really want to be involved in the musicals. And she said, well, you can't, because there's no activities bus, that drives out to the country to drive you off, and I don't want you, and I begged her, I said, look, Mom, I'll walk home, because she said she couldn't pick me up, and I said, I'll walk home. And back then it was safe, and so I was involved in the and it wasn't quite dark yet, but I walked 3.5 miles every single day for about 4 or 5 weeks during the rehearsals of, I was in Brigadoon and My Fair Lady and several of the musicals that we did in high school. And I would sing all the way home. It was just so much fun. It didn't seem like 3.5 miles at all. It was just, you know, just walked and sang. And before I knew it, I was back home. Stayed home, did my homework, and then started my next day routine, as kids do, you know.
You know, when I was in sixth grade, and this is sort of one of my stories, but I'll make it really simple. We were asked to write a short story. And I wrote a short story about alien abduction. This was a long time ago. And I was told to come into this room with the art teacher and the music teacher. And they told me they were going to make this story and with another story, they were going to combine them and make a musical. So wow. I actually was involved in creating a musical with a bunch of different people when I was in sixth grade, and it actually was performed. And that was sort of my first little victory in my life. And so I know what it's like to kind of want these things at a very young age and feel that you're moving in some direction, some kind of sense of guidance.
Yes, and I think also gives all of us that drive and that ambition and that also that interest is that I think we all have natural God-given talents. You have that natural God-given talent to write. I have a natural God-given talent to sing. And I think when you have the talent, you know it. We all know what our gifts are. We all know what we've been gifted. And so if we take those gifts, no matter what it might be, if you take those gifts and you utilize them, then they develop into something. It's like a flower. It's like a bud. You know, you take this little seed and it blossoms into a beautiful flower. And I think that's what life is all about, taking the gifts, the God-given gifts that we have, and utilizing them to the fullest of our abilities and having that creativity. You know, so certain people have a gift of hospitality. Other people have a gift of maybe cooking, and whatever your gift might be, I'd say, you know, take that gift and utilize it, and good things can happen, because that's kind of what molds our entire universe, our world, you know, to have, you know, if you look around, you can see that there's abundance of talent in every kind of realm, every kind of industry. There's an abundance of talent, and I believe that all comes from the God-given gift that we have.
Well, you know, we're going to take a break now, but the first sort of commercial is about, it is a book that I wrote with Ray Boylan. Later on, we'll listen to a clip of his book about his autobiography. This is a book based on his life. He's the soldier who became a crime fighter that I talked to you about before. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have a commercial break, and we're going to play something about a book called Boots in Manhattan, and then followed by a little ad for my friend Sandra LaFlamme. So here we go. Well, back with Threshold with Patricia Welch. You know, one of the things that one of the songs I really like a lot that's in your album is a song called Fly Me to the Moon, which I remember was in the beginning of the one of my favorite movies, Wall Street. Can you tell us something about that song?
Well,
the actual history of it?
Yes, actually, Fly Me to the Moon was written by Bart Howard, and actually he wrote it, and it was the original name was called In Other Words, and Kay Ballard was the, in 1954, was the first recording artist for that song. And it was called In Other Words. But Peggy Lee, back in 1960, actually convinced Bart Howard to change the name. So the name was changed from In Other Words to Fly Me to the Moon, and that's when Peggy Lee recorded it. And of course, you know, since then, so many artists of Frank Sinatra and just so many great, great singers have recorded that song. It's a very happy, sweet song, And it happens to be my husband's daughter's favorite song. In fact, that's one of the reasons I put it on my CD, because she said, Patricia, will you record Fly Me to the Moon? And I said, absolutely. For you, Suzanne, I will do that.
Well, let's hear it. Let's hear Fly Me to the Moon.
Okay.
Patricia?
Yes.
It sometimes takes a long time to get to the moon, doesn't it?
Yes.
Well, I know that when you were trying to get to the moon and you knew where you were going, you began to train yourself. You went to college and became a music major, but also you studied under a former Metropolitan Opera star. Can you tell us about that experience?
Yes. Metropolitan Opera star Frances Yin, she was what they call a spinto soprano, which is like a soprano that's kind of between a mezzo and a lyric, and they have this like wonderful spin to their voice. And she was just really a wonderful teacher, and I loved working with her. And actually, that's what kind of, I started out loving Broadway, then I worked a little bit towards opera, but then I loved acting so much, and I just kind of went back to Broadway. And but I am classically trained, definitely classically trained. I don't know if people can hear that in my voice.
I think so. But I do think they can hear it.
Yeah.
If they listen to your songs, they'll know that this is something
right.
Kind of extraordinary in terms of
you.
What you bring to the pop
thank
arena.
Thank you.
Well, tell us about some other types of training that you actually did, because it wasn't just the opera.
Well, I grew up in West Virginia, and we talked about that earlier, about the rural area. And so my stepfather, he loved country music. And so, you know, you can imagine a young 14, 15-year-old vocalizing and working on classical pieces hour after hour, day after day. It kind of got on his nerves a little bit, and he would say, okay, enough of that. How about singing some real music? And so to make him happy, I would, you know, sing a Patsy Cline tune or, you know, something country. And then I actually, at Capital City Music Hall, I did some backup there. And I just started, like, doing everything. I started enjoying, I have a wide range, first of all, at 4 octaves. So I guess I have the capability to be able to do that. But it took a little while to transition into from that soprano. And on this Cocktail CD, you hear a lot more soprano. But, like, when I really do, like, the Faith Hill stuff and the Reba McEntire, it's get down country, no sopranos coming through at all. It's total, kind of like a heads and tails. You know, I got the heads voice and I got the tail, you know, different, you know, different sounds. So, and I like that. I like to be able to have different colors. And but it's important for me, most important for me is that in a song is the lyric. If I can't believe the song or feel the lyric, I can't sing the song. And luckily there's enough great songs out there that have great lyrics. And you by speaking of lyrics, have the most interesting, unusual lyrics that fit with Edgar's songs. Edgar Ahrens, the Russian composer we talked about earlier.
Thank you.
And it's really unique music. It's kind of a little bit out of the box. A little bit, I kind of call it maybe, like Enya is out of the box and totally different. And I think that's kind of where our music can go. Not in that category, but being as what I'm trying to say is the differentiality, the uniqueness of what you and Edgar and I have put together is so unique, and it's really different. It's not like anything out there, so which I think could be a good thing.
I think so. You know, I want to get back to, you know, you had your formal training that we talked about, but I think there's another type of training that you had, and that is the training you had by actually doing it. And one of the earlier experiences, wouldn't you say, is when you worked with Yul Brynner when you returned to Broadway with The King and I.
Yes, I was a very young girl, you know, out of college, and decided to go to New York. And I went to New York with $1,400 in my pocket, which back then I thought that was a lot of money. Well, it didn't last more than a few weeks between cabs and food and hotels and so forth. And so, but they had it. Luckily, I was just, it was kind of a Cinderella story, because I was in New York And I was ready to leave because of I was out of money, and I actually wired, asked my mom to wire me a little bit, just kind of sustain just a little bit longer. And so I was walking out of the Western Union, and literally I bumped into a college friend, somebody that I went to college with from West Virginia, and she lived in New York City. And we started talking, and I said, oh my gosh, you know, it was just like she recognized me, I recognized her. And this is one of these fate things, right, that we talked about earlier.
Exactly.
And
yes.
And so I told her that I was getting ready to leave, and I just didn't think I could stay in New York anymore. I'm out of money, and I don't want to keep bleeding my mother, you know. So so anyway, Marsha McIntosh, that's her name, she said, you know, let me talk to my sister. We live in a Upper West Side apartment, and we have a two-bedroom, but if she says you can sleep on the couch, we've got a closet and a couch. I said, I'll take it. You talk to your sister. And so I gave her a number. I was at the Y, back then they didn't have cell phones, or I didn't have a cell phone. And so I was at the YWCA, and I said, please call this number and let me know. And so she called that evening and said that I could stay. Long story short, the following week, they had the open call audition. I wasn't even an equity actress. I wasn't union or anything. They had an open call for The King and I. And
wow.
I got called back. And then I got called back again and again, you know, because there's several callbacks before you get to that point. And then they said Yul Brynner was in Japan and that he wanted to hear me. Well, there were like 10 women that he wanted to hear, that they narrowed it down to for the role of Tup Tim. Six were Asian. Four of us were non-Asian. And I said, there's no way in the world I'm going to get this role. But for some reason, they picked me. I don't know why.
Was Yul Brynner there? He was there.
He was there for the final audition. And so I met him, and we all had to sing the one song that Tup Tim sings. She sings three songs in the show, two duets with Lunta, the man that she's in love with, and then she sings My Lord and Master, because she's a present. Tup Tim is a gift to the king. And so Yul Brynner was there, and he had every one of us, all 10 women, sing My Lord and Master. And when I sang it, he just came up to me on stage. I was the only one that he came, and he said, take your shoes off and sing it again and just walk the stage while you sing it. And I did that. I still didn't think I was going to get the part. And then I got back to my friend's apartment that evening. But the next morning, I got a call from Mitch Lee. Mitch Lee wrote Man of La Mancha, and he was co-producer with Yul Brynner. So it was called the King Lee Company at the time. This was the final Broadway revival of The King and I, 1980 to 85. And Mitch Lee called me up, and he said, we'd like to have you do the role of Tup Tim. We'd like for you to come in and sign a contract. Now, when I went to sign the contract, this is kind of all ties into that fate thing. Do you know what my starting salary was?
No.
It was $1,400 a week. That's exactly what I ended up going to New York with, was that $1,400. So I was like, oh my, that was $1,400 plus per diem, which was really nice back in 1980. And that's what my salary was. So I was like, oh my gosh, this is all fate. So I took the role, and Cinderella's story happened. And here I am many, many years later. But that was the beginning. I think that was the door opener for me, because I think when you have a great break like that in history, then only good things can happen after that. And I got my lucky break back in 1980 with Yul Brynner.
No, I was checking up on Yul Brynner's story. He also had, I'm sure, a lot of help, because his father left his family.
Yes.
And his mother took him with his sister to China. And then they went to Paris. And he played guitar in cafes and stuff. He came to USA and he worked as a broadcaster for us, for the United States, and broadcast occupied France, which he had lived in. He could speak fluent French. And then he started to study with Michael Chekhov. So he was kind of musical too, you know, before even this happened to him. And so, you know, he was actually on the stage. Did you know this 4,625 times?
Yes, and I did 2,000 some performances with him.
Did you really?
Yes, I did.
What were the actual songs that you were singing?
That I sang or that Yul Brynner sang?
That you sang.
I sang We Kiss in a Shadow.
You're beautiful.
And I Have Dreamed.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, my big solo is My Lord and Master. And then I also narrated a 25-minute ballet in the show. It's a beautiful ballet. Maybe it's about 20 minutes, but it was a beautiful ballet called The Small House of Uncle Thomas. It was based on Uncle Tom's Cabin and slavery, and Tup-Tim wanted to get this message across to the king because she felt she was enslaved and trapped because she loved Lunta. Lunta was the emissary who brought her to the king, and she was already in love with him, but they had no chance because she was gifted to the king from her king, you know, from Burma. And so she had to, she had to kind of basically go with the flow, even though she was very unhappy. And Mrs. Anna in the show says, you know, Your Majesty, of what interest to you is Tup-Tim? She's just like, you know, one bowl of rice is like any other bowl of rice. And he says, now you understand about women. Because he had like 60 wives or whatever. I don't have
Well, listen, Patricia, we're going to go to a break in a minute.
Okay.
I just want to say that it's really great to have you here.
Thank you.
We're going to have another exciting hour together in just a little while. We'll take a break for a few minutes.
Yes, and we can talk about our music, what you and Edgar and I did together.
Yes, that would be wonderful too. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we will be back at Threshold talking with Patricia Welch, who has just created her own CD, a three-part CD called Cocktails, Dinner, and Dessert with Patricia. And we will be back. Welcome back to Threshold. We're with Patricia Welch, who, besides being a great performer, and we've talked a little bit about her career, and we'll talk about more of it later, has worked with me and a Russian composer named Edgar Ahrens, who actually lives in Moscow, and who contacted Patricia on a social media site called Academy, which no longer really exists by that name. Anyway, she liked him and liked his music, and at the same time, he had begun to talk to me about working with him through the same social media site, and he had only really written scores for movies and TV. And he thought at one point that I was a producer, but I wasn't really a producer like that. I wanted to, but I did want to write songs. When I heard his music, it was phenomenal. And so he brought us together. He was in Moscow and brought me together with Patricia, who lived 30 miles away from me. And so it was an amazing coincidence. And these are two people, the only two people I've ever met who could, at that time, could perfectly sense what I wanted from this rather unusual, these rather unusual lyrics. So, Patricia, do you remember when we started with, after Christmas in Your Eyes, we started with a song called Love Never Withers?
Yes, I do. I do.
What did you think of that when you saw that, so those lyrics and so forth?
You know what? I loved it because your lyrics are so visual. I can just see all of it done to video. I mean, it's so visual. And there's a lot of colors in your lyrics. There's a lot of, they're very vivid and very, and I also love the uniqueness because it's kind of like not the norm, not the way we normally, as I said earlier, it's out of the box. It's a little different. And then that fused together with Edgar's writing, which is he has that
yes,
cinematic quality because he's been involved in film and television in Moscow, is kind of like that formula that puts it all together, that, you know, gives it that icing on the cake, so to say.
So what we're going to do is we're going to hear the song. It's called Love Never Withers. We're just going to play a piece of some of these songs, and then maybe we'll play our first song that is actually available to people right now. These songs are coming up, but here's Love Never Withers. Hi, Patricia. Hello?
Yes,
Patricia?
Hello, Johnny. Hello.
Yeah, we're being treated to some a little bit of shall we say musical and commercial chaos, but
yeah.
It's just the way it goes sometimes in life, and sometimes out of chaos comes some beautiful things. I don't know about you, but when I write, I don't necessarily know what I'm going to write or what I'm going to do. And that particular song, I don't know, like Love Never Withers, I didn't really get it, but I mean, I knew that there was a song there, and I started to write, and then I began to see, you know, the leaves being painted yellow and brown and so forth, red and brown, and I just started to see the whole thing, and it all finally came together.
Right, the correlation. I love how you have the correlation of love never withers and how nature, what happens with nature and the leaves and so forth, that, you know, that might happen with nature, but that does not happen with love.
Yes, there's something, you know, I guess after all I've seen and experienced in my life, I still believe in love, you know. I still believe in, as impossible as it sometimes would have seemed, that love can endure, and, you know, endure as far as you can imagine. It's like a highway that goes on forever. Another song that we did together, which I think is sort of a hyperbolic, a kind of exaggerated song, just like many of these songs that are in this album that's coming up, which is called Hadley's Castle. And this song is Your Kisses Never Die. And are you ready for that?
Yes.
Okay, well, let's hear your rendition of Well, the next song, we heard a little clip of it before. It's called Desperate Games. Don't you think that most of this music from Hadley's Castle is sort of, there's a sort of exaggerated feeling about it, both good and bad?
Yes, it does. It has, because with every love relationship, there's many, sometimes there are those downsides or those times of feeling like you just don't have, that you're not on the same page, and that maybe one person is loving the other one a little bit more, and or not feeling the love back, and so that the struggles of love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and well, this next song is almost the exact opposite, I think, because we played a little bit of it before, but because it's kind of love where you just are glued to that person, and you know that person is the wrong person, and you just can't get that him or her out of your head, right?
Right, right.
Yeah. And it's—I don't know. It just, what was interesting about all of this was that the story came to me after I wrote the songs, and it's kind of in a really interesting, it's like I've had that experience before, writing a bunch of songs, and there's one another musical that I'm working on now where all the different parts just came to me, and then I saw the story. So that's the strange thing about life. Well, here we go with Desperate Games. Patricia, thank you for doing that.
That's one of my favorites that we did together. I really, really like that song.
It's you know, I remember what Leonard Cohen said when did you ever hear his speech when he got the Prince of Asturias Award?
No, I didn't.
Well, what he said was, you know, I like awards and I'm glad to get it and I'm really appreciated, but you know what? It just seems like I'm more of a custodian of this song than I just completely wrote it myself. So maybe, you know, in a lot of times you think, oh my gosh, maybe that higher power that connected us is the same higher power that's working through us to create performances and lyrics and music. It's just kind of, there's another dimension to it.
Yes, absolutely.
In fact, this next song, of which I also love the way you did it, was one of the hardest to write. It was actually originally some kind of a spiritual song in Russia that Edgar composed, and we turned it into a, you know, an English song. And although it has a definite romantic quality about it, it's sort of a religious. It has a religious quality too, because what is your heart ready for? It's ready for forgiveness and love with a person, but it's also ready for a spiritual awakening. And this song is called My Heart Is Ready. So, what do you think of that?
Another very vivid, vivid song, and it very expressive.
Well, we're going to move a little bit away from Hadley's Castle and do the... There are a couple of songs, well, one particular song that is not in Hadley's Castle, and it's about... it's really sort of based on how I got to Palm Springs Lullaby, with the mood and the actual circumstances exaggerated by about 1,000 times. but I know that you know Palm Springs Lullaby very well. I mean, you know Palm Springs, and we are going to be making a music video for that song. And also, it will be coming out as a, sort of a single, and we're just going to play a piece of it. So I feel like that you really put your heart into this as well.
Yes, you know, speaking of Palm Springs Lullaby, I love it because you incorporated the windmills. And if anybody has ever been to Palm Springs, the windmills are right there. And so they'll hear it in the song.
Here we go with the Palm Springs Lullaby. Well, Patricia, that was a Christmas surprise, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
It's just like opening up a stocking and you didn't know what was in it. And there it is. and actually you thought it was Halloween. But
well, that was two of our songs back to back. And speaking of...
That was the only complete one that we were playing. That people can actually find that on YouTube.
Yes. And you know, Christmas in Your Eyes, it's a kind of a very unusual... Can I talk about it for a moment?
Oh, please.
It's a very...
all the time you want.
Okay. It's an unusual Christmas song, you know, in the fact that it's about a family, about a mother and her child going out, and the child is sledding. And this child tumbles down the hill and could have been killed, and this beautiful pine, this beautiful tree, broke this child's fall. And so this family in the evening at the fireside, you know, are just in celebration of this miracle of this child not getting killed and this tree saving the child. And so it's an unusual, as I said, all of our music is out of the box. It's a little different and has a little different messages. And I think that kind of makes it, that uniqueness makes it, should make it interesting for the listeners out there. The way Edgar wrote that music, the way your lyrics kind of folded in, and then they can actually watch that video on YouTube, but you can tell them in a minute where they can find that. But it's very visual, you know, the child is being tucked in, and it's a very peaceful, happy, everybody's happy, everybody's safe, if the family is safe, and, you know, that's what that song is all about. At Christmas time, the family is safe, and they have each other.
Yeah. That was the idea. It was a universal Christmas song, mm-hmm. that captured, I think, almost anybody, any faith could like it. And you can find it on YouTube. If you put in Patricia Welch, Christmas in Your Eyes, you'll find that song. It's really simple to find. I want to go back to, well, first of all, I'd like to go back to something else that's a little bit of a deviation. You actually have a... besides wearing the hat of a performer, you have I don't know if you're there for this reason, but you have a business that's intimately connected with Las Vegas, do you not?
Yes, actually, it's my husband's business, and I help him with it. That's my day job. You know, you have to have a day job when you're in my field.
Better than waiting in tables?
Exactly.
Exactly.
You know, it's nice to, we work, you know, right out of the office together. We're pretty much together 24/7, actually. He's not here with me because it's awfully early, but for him, but Yes, our business is called Las Vegas Perks, and people can find it at lasvegasperks.com. And basically what it is it's a discounted Las Vegas package for shows, dining, and attractions. And we actually have several packages. We've broken them down. We have one that's called the Deluxe Package, which contains all of our offers, shows, dining, and attractions. We have a dining package, we have an attraction package, tour and attraction package, and so forth. And what people do is they can go online and they can actually purchase these packages. They're very reasonable, and they can print out the coupons and then take them with them to Vegas. And what they will do is they'll purchase the package, for example, like the dining package is $15.95. They purchase it, and then they've got like lots of great two-for-one plus other significant offers in that package that they can take to Las Vegas. We've got the Paris Buffet. We've got some nice, really nice offers. So he actually started this business years ago. He created a board game called Casino Royale. And he,
oh, really?
Yeah, and he put this little coupon book in the board game, and the board game was in Walmart, but people were cutting the board game open, and they were stealing the little coupon box. So he said, I'm in the wrong business. I think I need to have the coupons, the discounts for Vegas. And so that's how he started that. And I've been helping him. He calls me the computer guru between the two of us. He's not really real computer, but I am. I've actually designed our site.
It's a really nice site.
Thank you. I did the website, and I take care of customer service, and so I wear many hats.
Well, you know, I will say this, that looking at these coupons, as I did recently, because I want to go to Vegas so I can actually meet everybody in the station. That would be a really great thing to do at one point. And you save hundreds of dollars on these packages, don't you?
Absolutely. Some of the shows are $70 and $80 shows, and we have a dinner show. And basically, yes, if they're two for one, why pay full price when you can get it for half? If there's a couple going, these really geared for couples are our packages. But most people go in twos to Vegas or fours, and they can basically buy the packages, and then they've got these tremendous savings.
Well, you know, with that in mind, I think we'll get back to another little adventure of yours, which is your CD, Cocktails, Dinner, and Dessert with Patricia. And I'd like to play a song which maybe you could tell us a little bit about, something called Top of the World.
Oh, yes, Top of the World. That was actually a song that Karen Carpenter sang years ago. And I've always loved that song. In fact, my husband had a heart valve replacement a couple years ago at UCLA. And I remember I was so happy because, you know, we just didn't know he was going to make it. And I was so happy that the doctor said everything was successful and he was in ICU. And I was walking back to the hotel after being with him for hours and hours, and he was in recovery. And I remember singing that song. I felt that's the way I felt. Those words to that song was the way I felt right after my husband's surgery, and I knew that he was going to be okay.
Well, that's wonderful. Let's hear it.
Okay.
You know, Patricia, you were talking about your husband's surgery.
Yes.
But I also recall when you were very, very sick, and some strange things happened during that time, but I was really at a distance from you, you know, physically at a distance, but I was extremely worried. And then things really kind of miraculously changed. Can you tell us what happened to some extent?
Yes, without going into all the gory details. I had a major surgery, and right. Where a lot of my intestines was taken out. And anyway, I had broken apart. They were stapled me together, and I broke apart, and I ended up with sepsis and pneumonia and all kinds of things. So I was in the hospital for a good 6 weeks, and then 3 months in a nursing home, and then I had a home nurse. They didn't expect me to live when I was in the hospital. It was a very, very dramatic recovery. But and there was a time when I was so sick I wanted to die. You know, I think there's times when you just feel so bad, you just say, dear God, please take me. But yes. But then it all goes into that fate thing again, because he didn't. He said, no, you're still here because I want you here, you know. And I think that, you know, when it's your time to go, it's your time. There's an old Chinese proverb, I heard it once. I don't have it exactly, but it's like, if it's your time to go, it's your time to go. A blade of grass can cut your toe and you could die. And 1,000 arrows thrown your way can hit you and you can survive. And that's basically kind of that motto, basically, the moral of that story is that, you know, if it really is your time, it's your time. And it wasn't. And I'm here. I am completely recovered. I got down to 100 pounds. I'm like 5'5", so that was nothing. And I was really, really sick. But, you know, I bounced back and I gained my weight back. And I feel wonderful now. And I'm thankful to the doctor in the hospital and everything, because they gave me the best care. It was at Eisenhower Medical Center, by the way, in Palm Desert.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
and where we used to live, right?
Yeah, and
where
they I used to live. they were absolutely wonderful, and I really truly believe my doctor saved my life, because when I had like 105 fever and they knew something was really wrong with a raging infection of sepsis, he took me right back up to OR after operating all day and, you know, like in the middle of the night, and he worked so hard at getting me back together again and really saved me. And then the blood transfusions and so forth after that all were all stepping stones to get me well again. And the medications, the heavy duty Invance, which was like a major antibiotic, all
One
that.
Of the strangest stories that I heard about this type of fate.
Mm-hmm.
I have related it, I think, once before, but there's a guy named Fritz Peters who he became a writer. But he was in World War II before that, and I believe he was in occupied France. I'm not sure, but there was a tent that he was in with his fellow soldiers, and a bomb hit it. It exploded the tent and it killed everybody in it. He was outside the tent and he saw something flying through the air and it landed in his feet. It was a typewriter.
A typewriter? During this whole ordeal?
Yeah, he became a novelist. But
wow.
So
from the tent,
his life was saved because he happened to be outside of this tent where all his friends were killed.
Wow.
So, I mean, that's something.
And so he was the one that lived to write about it, right?
He lived to write about it, and the typewriter became really important to him.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I was thinking that maybe we've talked a lot about Edgar, and Edgar is a good friend of both of ours, a remote friend, because we both never actually seen him, right, except on Skype.
Right, right, right.
But, Edgar has asked me to work with him, like you have. And I'd like to play a little promo for his music, for not his songs, but for his actual scoring of music.
Yes, and he can be found at edgararons.com, right? Is that his web address?
Yes, edgararons.com, edgararens.com, and you can hear a lot of his music there.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go ahead and play that.
Okay.
Well, this is really... I think his music, that particular, the Secret Agent's Memoirs, was played on Netflix. Did you know that?
No, I did not.
I think it was Netflix.
I'm going to have to Google that and watch it.
Watch it, but it is with subtitles.
Yeah. He's a tremendous composer, isn't he? I mean, you can just beautiful, beautiful.
I really, honestly, when I first heard it, I said, this is John Williams, or this is someone on that stature.
Mm-hmm.
This is not an ordinary person.
I know. And when I heard his music, I was drawn to it. And, you know, that when we met through E Academy, I was like, whoa, I want to work with this guy. And then I met you through him, which you were just a hop and a skip away from where I lived.
It's incredible.
Yes, yes.
Well, that's one reason I did this program, is because I felt that you look at all the terrible problems we have in this world, and there's got to be some kind of a spiritual answer. There's got to be a component to take us out of some of this darkness.
Yes.
And I felt that I would take everything that I could understand and perhaps draw some other people who understand more into a matrix where we could look at things from a spiritual perspective. And as you can see, just the things that we've related so far, how our lives became entwined, how you became well after such a devastating disease, how you connected with someone who got you the information about the king and I. It's beyond ordinary chance. It gets into the realm of what you call synchronicity, where you have things connecting with a meaning, but that shouldn't really connect in that way, because if life is arbitrary and random, then things like this would not happen, but it's not.
That's right. That's right.
I'd like to play, go back to your CD and play something called Someone Like You. Can you tell us a little about that?
Yes, actually, the CD has mostly songs from the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, the 80s, the standards. But this song is actually from a Broadway show. It was from Jekyll and Hyde, and I just loved it because it's such a beautiful love song. So I kind of threw that one in. I figured that's easy listening and beautiful, and I thought people would enjoy it. So that was one of the, I think it was in 1990 for Jekyll and Hyde when it came out, 1990 or 1991. So here it is, Someone Like You.
You know, Patricia, when I hear that song, it seems to me it could have been done in the 70s or the 60s. When you listen to show music, it seems to me that it has a more of a perennial quality. It seems to, I mean, it can be dated in a way, but in another sense, it just seems alive. Like I saw Guys and Dolls recently, the film, and it's just like the songs are totally understandable now.
Yes, yes, absolutely. And isn't that a beautiful song?
Oh, it's an amazing song. And I thought, well, I must have heard this, you know, years ago. And I guess I hadn't really even heard it because I thought it was coming from an earlier era. But then again, you can't tell with these type of songs. You know, Patricia, I grew up, my uncle was named Hyde Jacobs. And he was, I don't know if I ever told you this, but he was in charge of all the advertising for the major musicals in the 70s and 80s and I think the early 90s.
Oh.
And so he I constantly went to Broadway, and I also constantly would play these musicals like Annie Gets Your Gun or Oklahoma over and over and over again.
Me so, too. That was part of my childhood, you know, in high school. As I said, I listened to Gordon McRae and Shirley Jones and played these for hours and hours, and I would actually turn Shirley Jones down and pretend like I was, you know, his romantic counterpart and sing along with Gordon McRae or Johnny Raitt.
Yeah. Well, let's listen to some information about your CD, because
okay,
we're almost at the end.
Okay.
Here.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes. And then my website too is patriciawelch.com.
Patricia, I was hoping you could give a little bit more about your own contact information about your website before we leave, which will be in about 1 minute.
Okay, yes, it's patriciawelch.com, very easy. And Welch is with a C-H. A lot of people get that mixed up and put that S in there, but it's just like the grape juice. No relation, I wish, but but it's patriciawelch.com.
Well, the wonderful thing about it, about your website, is that they can get a lot of different, you didn't just do that CD, you did a lot of other things, and you have a whole album about Broadway songs, correct?
Yes, absolutely. Broadway's Best with Patricia, and that actually is on Amazon and iTunes also, but they can find everything in my website. I have videos on my website, and you know, so people can contact me through email.
Thank you so much, Patricia. Thanks for being with us, and we'll see you next week on Threshold.
It was a delight. Thank you, Johnny.
Thank you. Take care.
You too.
Views and opinions expressed on this program were those of the hosts and guests and did not necessarily reflect those of Vegas All Net Radio, its affiliates, or its parent company.